but those who trust in the Lord will find new strength. They will soar high on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint. Isaiah 40, verse 31. Welcome to EagleM International Church with your hosts, Bishop Virgil D. Taylor and Pastor India Owens Taylor.
Everybody, we praise God, you guys, for taking our time to come into the broadcast on today. Those of y'all who may not be able to see when you come in, please mute your microphone. But we're going to go on and get the service started on today. And we're going to start it off with our opening prayer with our wonderful anointed woman of God, Pastor Clary, stating there in the Atlanta, as she put it, in the Atlanta, Georgia area. And she's going to come in and take us to the throne of God on today. All right, do what you do.
Amen. Father God, we worship you, God. We just thank you for this time of fellowship, God, with EMIC, God. We thank you, Father, for Bishop Virgil and Pastor India Taylor, God. We thank you for the entire EMIC family, Father, on this day, God. Lord, we just ask you, God, just show up and show out on this broadcast like never before, God. We ask that your Holy Spirit would have his way on this broadcast. Anoint every song. Anoint every scripture. Anoint every word. Anoint the message, God. Anoint the messenger, Father. Anoint the hearers, Father, in the name of Jesus, God, as we cry out, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. We're asking for your sovereign presence to show up throughout this broadcast, throughout the world, God, in the name of Jesus, God. Oh, God, move by your spirit, God, in an unprecedented way, Father, today, God, in the name of Jesus. Let this word reverberate throughout, hallelujah, every nation and every world, every tongue and every people, God. Everywhere, hallelujah, this voice goes forth, God. Let it anoint, let it set free, let it encourage, let it strengthen, Father, hallelujah, God. And we thank you that people will be healed, God. People will be delivered, God. People will be set free, and people will be saved and give their life back to you, God. Thank you, Father God, for this opportunity, Lord. And we give you the honor and we give you the praises even before we hear the mighty testimonies that are going to roar in, God. Hallelujah, as this word goes forth. Thank you, God. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah, God.
Amen. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. We thank Pastor Clarice for taking us to the throne of God on today. We're going to have our scripture reading. Psalms 150. We all familiar with this scripture. Psalms 151 through 6. Psalms 151 through 6. I'm going to have Pastor India to give us our scripture reading on today. All right? All right.
Psalm 150, 1 through 6. Praise ye the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in the firmament of his power. Praise him in his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise him with sounds of
psalms
the
trumpet.
Praise him with mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. 3. Praise him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise him with psaltery and harp. Praise him with the timbrel and dance. Praise Him with string instruments and organs. Praise Him upon the loud cymbals. Praise Him upon the high-sounding cymbals. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of His word.
Amen. We praise God for Pastor India giving us the scripture reading, Psalms 151 through 6. And sorry, I had to move the camera a little bit, guys. A little technical issue going on there. We're going to bless you with these two videos. And I want you to hear what God is saying in the videos. And then we're going to go right into what God has to say to us on today. And of course, we're going to have our blessed Holy Communion. Amen.
Walking in your freedom now, covered by your grace, witnessing your healing power. We have been changed.
not seeing you. I do see a Galaxy A5. I don't know who that is. I need everybody to mute their microphone, please. Galaxy A5, there you go. Mute your mic. I don't know who you are, but somebody in the dark. That's all I know. It looked like it might be Pastor Jacob. Amen, amen, amen. We praise God for you guys joining in on the broadcast on today. We praise God for you. And there is word. There is a word from the Lord on today, people of God. Like I said, we don't take you for granted when you're coming to the broadcast, when you're busy scheduled on Saturday, especially my pastors that are in other parts of the world. You got your own thing going on, so I know you're taking time out. Once you finish your ministry, you're coming in to EMIC Fellowship Ministry. So we praise God for you. We don't take that for granted by no stretch of the imagination. We really don't. But there is a word. There is a word from the Lord on today, people of God. There is a word. And I want everyone, let's get your Bibles out, because you guys are going to have to go back and take notes. I'm letting you know now. Okay, I want all my leaders, I want you to just look at it the first time. I want you to go back and actually take notes for what the Lord has to say, so you be able to minister this word also to your people. Okay? All right. Well, first of all, let's go to St. Luke, the 24th chapter. We got a couple of scriptures we're going to read, first of all. And then we're going to get right into the meat of the word. Luke 24, 45th verse through the 49th verse. And we're going to let the Holy Ghost speak through the word of God on today. No philosophy, no theology, just the word of God. Amen? Amen, amen, amen. St. Luke, the 24th chapter, the 45th verse through the 49th. Then opened he their understanding, that they might understand the scriptures, and said unto them, thus it is written, and thus it behooved Christ to suffer, and was raised from the dead the third day. And the 47th verse says, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And ye are witnesses of these things. And behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until you be endued with power from on high. Amen? Amen. Amen. Now I want you to go over to John, the third chapter. St. John, the third chapter, starting at the third verse. St. John, the third chapter, starting at the third verse. Jesus answered and said unto him, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus saith unto him, how can a man be born when he is old? Can he either enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus said unto him, he said, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. That which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I say unto you, you must. It's not an option. You must be born again. Amen? Amen? Now let's go over to, I told you we're gonna let the word of God speak for itself on today. Let's go over to Acts, the first chapter. We're going to skip around a little bit there. Acts, the first chapter. And we're going to start at the fourth verse. We're going to read the fourth verse, the fifth verse, and the eighth verse. Okay. I'm going to give you guys a little time to get to it. Acts, the first chapter, starting at the fourth verse. And being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father. This is what we read just a few minutes ago. Which saith he, you have heard of me. For John truly baptized you. He truly baptized you with water. But ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. Okay? Now let's go down to the eighth verse. But you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in Judea and in Samaria and unto the utmost part of the earth. Amen. Amen. Now I want you to go to Acts, and this is going to be our main scripture. I want you to go to the second chapter of Acts. The second chapter of Acts, and we're going to start at the 14th verse. The second chapter of Acts, starting at the 14th verse. But Peter, standing upon with the 11, lifted up his voice and said unto them, Ye men of Judea, and all ye that dwell in Jerusalem, be this known unto you, and hearken to my word. For these are not drunken, as ye suppose, seeing it is but the third hour of the day. And in Jewish time, that would have been around 9 o'clock. But this is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. And it shall come to pass, in the last days, saith God, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. And on my servants and on my handmaidens, I will pour out in those days of my spirit, capital S, and they shall prophesy. And I will show wonders in heaven above and signs in the earth beneath, blood and fire, vapor of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before that great notable day of the Lord comes. The 21st verse. And it shall come to pass that whomsoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. We thank God for the reading of His word. His word is already blessed. But we praise God that He counted us worthy to give us His word for instruction, for rebuke, and to let us know exactly what is expected of us. Exactly that which is expected of us. The title to the thought on today, the message that the Lord gave me to give you all on today is this. The baptism of the Holy Ghost is for you. It is for you. Make no question about it. It is for you. It is for you. Father God, we thank you, Lord God, for another day that you've blessed us to see, Lord God. We take not this day for granted. Father, we know it could have gone another way. However, God, we know we're here for a purpose. Our season is not up yet. Help us to deliver your word, Lord God, on today with power and anointing, Lord God. Let me hide behind the cross, Lord God. Let your people see you. And let them hear you on today, Father God. Have nothing to offer but your people of God, people of God, but your word on today. We pray this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 People of God, one thing that I've noticed in today's church world, notice I said church world, that there's a very liberal theology out there that Christians can live any kind of way and still make it into heaven. The devil is a liar. Some Christians are being taught that water baptism and the baptism of the Holy Ghost are no longer required. I beg to differ with that. Based upon the actions of the first century church, and notice what I'm saying. When I say first century church, because that's when the church was established. Second and third century, some things started to creep into the church that was not of God, and Paul told us about it. Okay? So a lot of times when you all hear me reference first century church, I'm going to the original foundation of what the Lord set up in His church and how the apostles set up things in the church. So again, I beg to differ with that type of theology. This type of theology is not based upon the Holy Scriptures, but by man's theological and philosophical view of the Scriptures. Unfortunately, there are many who study the Scriptures but do not have a real relationship with the God of the Scriptures. You may say, why you say that, preacher? Well, let me give you some examples of what I'm saying. The Lord told Nicodemus, and we just read it a few minutes ago in John 3:3-7, that you must, man of God, be born again. There's an understanding that Nicodemus was a ruler of our people. He was a Pharisee. He was one who sat on the Sanhedrin Council, whose name in Hebrew actually means conqueror or ruler of the people. He was a well-studied man of God. He knew Jewish theology, so he was not a novice. But he needed a deeper understanding of the spiritual workings of God. The Lord made it very clear to this leader of the people that even though that he had a great status in life, it was not enough. The Lord wanted Nicodemus to understand that even though he was a great religious authority, he still needed to be born again of both the water and of the Spirit. Also, the Lord made it very clear. And when he explained to him, he said, Nicodemus, you can't even discern. You can't even see the kingdom of God, no less than actually enter into it without having the born again experience. The key to that is that Nicodemus had a teachable spirit and was willing to learn. Unfortunately, people of God, there are many Christians out there who reject or just not knowledgeable in regards to the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Well, it is my assignment on today to explain, to introduce, or even just stress it to you that the baptism of the Holy Ghost is for you today. It is a necessary, I didn't say option, it is a necessary part of you being a Christian. You all can write this down, so it takes me into my point one. What is the importance of having the baptism of the Holy Ghost? Well, I want to give you this dictionary meaning out of Wikipedia, and then I'm going to go into something else. It says this: baptism with the Holy Ghost is an empowering experience equipping spirit-filled believers for witnessing and ministry. Extending from this is the belief that all spiritual gifts mentioned in the New Testament are to be sought and experienced in the body of Christ. In the body of Christ. And I agree with that definition. People of God, I want to give you some examples in the Scriptures of what I'm saying. That it is necessary for you to have the power of God operating in your life. Now, I want to read this for you before I get into this other portion. Because like I said, I want to show you the importance of having the Holy Ghost, or being baptized in the Holy Ghost. And I want to read this. I'm reading from Romans, the 8th chapter. And I'm going to read the whole thing, 5 through 14, because I want you all to get this. I don't want you to have a misunderstanding in regards to having the Spirit of God or the baptism of the Holy Ghost. It's not just a feel-good, and it does make you feel good. It's not just a feel-good emotion, okay? Romans 8, 5 through 14. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. To be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is entity. The carnal mind, worldly mind, is entity against God. For it is not subject to the law of God. Neither indeed can it be. It can't even be. Because it's carnal. Okay? But ye are not in the flesh. People have got you not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If so, notice what the Scripture is saying. If so be that the Spirit of God, Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit, whatever you feel comfortable with, dwell in you. Now this portion right here is very important. Now, if any man, woman, boy, child of God, have not the Spirit of God or the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. He is none of his. But if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. But if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, meaning the Holy Ghost, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal body by his Spirit that dwells in you. Therefore, brethren, we are no longer debtors to the flesh, but we live to, live after the flesh. For if we live after the flesh, ye shall die. But if you through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body, you shall live. Again, I'm right there where I'm telling you the importance of having the Holy Ghost. Very, very important. Like I said, not an option, not a feel-good emotion, but it's essential. Again, the Lord made it very clear to his disciples on one occasion in Acts 1, 4, 5, and 8 that we read earlier, that they were not to leave Jerusalem. Don't go do no ministry, don't have no conferences, don't do no prayer room sessions, but wait for the gift of the Father promised that was going to be sent to them. He said in verse 5, for John truly baptized you with water. Yeah, you've been baptized. But in a few days you shall receive power. After that the Holy Ghost comes upon you. You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria. In other words, you will have a global ministry. But in order for you to do that, I need to instill my Spirit, my power within you, in order for that to happen. Notice what he said to the disciples, child of God. Again, in Luke 24:19, he said, wait for the promise. And in the day, we used to call them tarrying services. That was a long time ago. And now that's all it meant, just wait. Just wait on God. Wait on God to fill you with the Holy Ghost. That's really all it meant. I know some people look down on that now, but I don't know, maybe we should get back to some basics and we have some more power in the church. But I'll move right along. Okay? Notice what he said. Again, he said, wait, don't go nowhere. Again, I'm going to say this again. I hear the Holy Ghost saying, say it again. Don't do nothing. I don't want you to usher. I don't want you to play drums. I don't want you to do nothing until you have the Holy Ghost. I know that goes against a whole lot of folk theology, but hey, it's the word. It's the word. Verse 8 says, until you have the power. That may be the reason why a lot of folk can't live right. Don't have no power. I'm just saying. Child of God, the disciples knew. They understood about the water baptism. They had that on lock. They understood that. But because of the fact that they had been baptized under John's baptism, they still needed to be filled with the Holy Ghost. Which means, even though some of you all out there, you've been baptized, but you still need to be filled with the Holy Ghost. This goes past theology, it goes past your philosophy of life, it goes past your mental state, your intellect. It has nothing to do with that. This baptism will give you the power for ministry that God has called you to. Let me give you an example in the scriptures where there were those who had been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus, but had not received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Well, what scripture you have for that? Well, I'm glad you asked. Acts 8 and 14. You go check these out as the Berean saints. Go check out what I'm saying, and you might learn something. It says this now. When the apostles which were at Jerusalem heard that the Samaritans had received the word of God, they sent them. They sent both Peter and John, for the Holy Ghost had not fallen upon them. They had been baptized, but they had not received the Holy Ghost. and said, they said, well, these new believers, these Samaritans, we got to get to them. We got to make sure that they have what they need. They received the word, but we need them to be filled with the Holy Ghost. And notice what happened when the apostles laid their hands on them. They received the Holy Ghost immediately. Immediately. People of God, having the baptism of the Holy Ghost will make you more effective in your global witness to the world. It's not enough, pastors, and I'm speaking to my pastors, it's not enough for you to hoop to people. It's not enough for you to emotionalize the people. But give them the sound doctrine of the Word of God. Something that's going to stick to their ribs. My mother used to say, you know, junk food is okay, but you need some taters. Something that's going to be able to stick to the ribs. So when you're going through, and you will go through, that's just life. That's just life. You got something that you can call up as the paraclete. You have something that you actually have some true substance there that will help you to get through. Amen? It's obvious to me. You all can read it in the Word for yourself. It's obvious to me that the apostles in Jerusalem thought it was vital for them to come to the newly baptized Samaritans so they could also experience the baptism of the Holy Spirit. If they had heard, now obviously they heard the Samaritans had been baptized. Notice this now. I want y'all deacons to get this. They had been baptized because they heard the preaching of Deacon Philip. It wasn't an apostle. It wasn't bishop. It wasn't Pastor Mucky Muck. They heard the preaching of Deacon Philip. And they believed. And because of the fact they believed on the gospel, they received. Amen. There was a point there. So deacons, you're not just there to be collecting funds. Sitting over in the corner. Preach the word. Preach the word. People of God, as it was in the day of Pentecost in Acts 2, 1 through 4, there were other saints of God who also received the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues, just like the 120. There was no difference. There was no difference. Let me give you an example of what I'm saying. I can give you a Bible to back up what I'm saying. I'm saying in the book of Acts 10, 40 through 43 through 45, it states this: all the prophets testified about him, that everyone who believes in him received forgiveness of sins through his name, whose name? Jesus. While Peter was still speaking those words, the Holy Ghost came on them who heard the message that was in Cornelius' house. Two different separate situations, the Samaritans and at Cornelius' house. Two different events. The circumcised, or our Jewish brothers, believers who had come down there with Peter, were astonished that the gift of the Holy Ghost had been poured out even on the Gentiles. Have mercy. It just wasn't a Jew thing. God was spreading his Holy Ghost to other folk too. Look at that. Child of God, you may ask, how did they know that the Gentiles had received the Holy Ghost? Well, I'm glad you asked that question. They had proof. You know why? Because they heard them speak in tongues and magnify and praise God. Then Peter said, can anyone forbid these folks from being baptized? I'm going somewhere with this. Can anybody forbid these folks from being baptized? No? Because they received the Holy Ghost. Notice this. Notice his words. They received the Holy Ghost just as we. Just as we, in other words, they received the Holy Ghost just like the 120 did back on the day of Pentecost, also the Samaritans. They received the Holy Ghost there in Cornelius' house just like they did. And how did they know? Because they heard them speak. They heard them speak in another tongue. Well, you may say, how did they know? Again, I'm going to reiterate that. They were in Cornelius' house. The Holy Ghost fell. And again, child of God, they heard them speak, and they said unto themselves, look, these guys received the Holy Ghost just like we did. They heard the people of God speaking in tongues just like they did. Child of God, Peter and others that were there were understood. They understood that this just wasn't a one-time occurrence. This was another occurrence of the same kind. Thank you, Holy Ghost. I hadn't thought about that way. This was the same occurrence, but in different venues, in different events, with two different set of people. Which proved again that this event was another fulfillment of what the prophet Joel spoke in Joel 2 and 28, which it says, I will pour out my spirit. Now, if I repeat that again, you might catch something. I will pour out my spirit. I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. All flesh. People of God, the event of Pentecost was not just a one-time event. One just a one-time event, one-time phenomenon, one-time miracle. Because you and I know, those of us who are filled with the Holy Ghost, know that this thing is happening all the time, and then it's happening in many places throughout the world, even as I speak. Notice what the scripture said. Notice what the scripture said. Through the apostles and others, Christ was preached. Christ was preached. The word of God says, if I be lifted up, who will draw? I will draw. Not all your programs, not all those what I call religious schemes. He said, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. I think a lot of times we use programs because there ain't no anointing. It's not a whole lot of anointing going on. So you had to come up with something else. That only lasts just for a minute. It only lasts just for a minute. And those of you all who are coming in, please mute your mic, guys. Okay? And say, you can fool the people sometimes, but you ain't gonna be able to fool them all the time. Notice, child of God, it's not on the script. That's downloaded. That's straight from God. Notice, child of God, in the scriptures, again, Christ was preached. Christ was preached. And they practiced both water baptism. I give you the scriptures for it. Acts 2:38, Acts 19:5, Acts 8 and 16. And receiving of the baptism of the Holy Ghost, they understood that they both had to happen. They both had to happen. Which takes me to my point too. The results of being filled with the Holy Ghost. These are some of the results. I'm going to just give you a few examples. In the scriptures. Again, I'm going to go back to what I told you before. The saints in the first century, and you all always going to hear me reference back to the first century church because that's where it was established. Second and third century, some other stuff started creeping in that really was not of God. Okay? Elder Mark Finnis and I had that conversation on yesterday. I know he's in there. Around 325 at the Nicaea Council, other things started coming in that were not of God. But let me give you an example. Let me give an example what the Lord was doing during that time period, which was to their benefit. Okay? Notice, child of God, what happened. Old cussing, denying Peter, after being filled with the Holy Ghost, Peter boldly preached an anointed message on the day of Pentecost. And guess what? 3,000 souls. Where? Cussing Peter, denying Peter before the Holy Ghost, after the Holy Ghost, an anointed Peter, birthday of the church opening up, 3,000 souls. They said, men and brethren, what do we do? What do we do to be saved? Obviously, there was some anointed word going in there cutting, because that's what the word of God does. It both cuts and it heals at the exact same time. 3,000 souls were added to the new church. That was the first mega church. And notice how they did it. Preach Jesus. That's how it began. That's how it should always be. Acts 2:41. Again, that's all a part of that. That was the first mega church. Spirit-filled Peter, once again. God used him to heal a lame man. And in doing so, two entire cities turned to the Lord. Two entire cities turned to the Lord. I'll show you where it is. It's in Acts 9, 40, through 42. Acts 3 and 1. 1 through 10, it'll talk in terms of Peter when he healed the crippled man again near the temple. Then another 5,000 folks were added to the Lord. How did that happen? Preaching Jesus, preaching Christ, Holy Ghost working, folk getting healed physically, mentally, spiritually. Let me tell y'all something. This is just a fact. Folk believe when they see. When they see the operation of the Holy Ghost, I'm not talking this weird stuff. When they see the operation of the Holy Ghost and seeing God operate in you, through you, not you, that gets their attention. That gets their attention. And they will find themselves coming to the Lord. Now, Deacon Stephen. Deacon? How y'all say it in the Baptist way? Deacon? Deacon? Deacon Stephen did many great wonders and miracles by the grace of God. Acts 6, 5, 6, 8. And then after they saw all that going on, and this was deacon. This was not apostle, it was not bishop, it was not prophet, it wasn't evangelist, it was deacon. After he preached Christ, folk got healed, they got delivered, all kind of wonderful things happened, and they came to the Lord. Spirit-filled Philip, again, performing many miracles and healings, casting out demons. And after that, people came to the Lord. You see what God is telling us, people of God? You see what God is telling us? Preach Christ. Preach Christ. But in order to do that with power, you can preach him, but it's something different when you have the power of God manifesting yourself through your life. And there were many other saints. There wasn't just the ones that we know about as far as the names are concerned. There were many other saints in the book of Acts. I call that the Holy Ghost Bible. That were filled with the Holy Ghost, that ministered the word of the Lord and power, and many souls were added to the kingdom. This proves that Acts 1 and 8, you said what's 1 and 8, okay, was true. Child of God, the baptism of the Holy Ghost will allow you to be a bold witness for the Lord, no matter where you are in the earth, whether or not folk are paying you to preach or teach or not, you're going to preach Jesus, whether or not it's something popular, whether or not it's a popular message. With the Holy Ghost, you won't preach Jesus. And yeah, sometimes that offends. But hey, it all comes with the territory. Comes with the territory. If you're looking to not get your feelings hurt, you're in the wrong business. you're in the wrong business. You might want to do something else. Experiencing the Lord in a true way. For all of those folk were baptized in the Holy Ghost, but not only were they baptized and filled up with God, but the Holy Ghost gave them spiritual gifts that would edify, that would build up the body of Christ. Well, we're going to get to a real good part here, because I know some of you all out there, and those of you all who have the baptism of the Holy Ghost, I'm going to still get back to you in a minute. But there are those out there that do not have, and they don't have an understanding exactly how all that works. Because they may say, well, preacher, how do I receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost? I'm going to just give you some examples of some things that can happen. And the Lord will give it to you, because he is a free gift. He's giving of himself to you. He wants to have you filled up with him. First of all, child of God, you must believe. Nothing happens unless you believe. You got to believe that this promise, free gift, is for you, according to Acts 2:39. And it's not just for a selected few. I know some of my theologians out there are going to say different. It was not for a selected few. Okay? You must repent. What are you saying, preacher, about repent? You got to turn from your sins. You got to turn from your sins. You got to make a bout for you. You got to make a complete turn. I'm not talking about mouth. I'm talking actions. You have to turn from your sins. You have to be baptized in water. Dip baptizo means immersed. You got to go down in the water. Then you will receive the gift of the Holy Ghost according to Acts 2:38. Child of God, the word says in Mark 16:15, get this, that he that believe, there I go back to that believe again, he that believe and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. I'm only speaking what the word says. Now, child of God, we know there were situations, again, and I want to reiterate this, there were situations, according to Acts 10, 47 through 48, at Cornelius' house, there were those who received the water baptism but had not received the Holy Ghost. We know what happened. So they went down in the water prior to getting the Holy Ghost, or prior to receiving the Holy Ghost. That was remedied because they got both. Amen? And you will notice this, that again, it all goes back to believing. You got to believe. You will not receive him. You will not receive him unless you believe. The moment you believe that this gift is for you, that the infilling of the Holy Ghost is for you, prime then. You prime then. That's when God said, oh, I can come in now. I can come in now because now the environment is right. But as long as you try to fight it, and you try to find all kinds of scriptures to back up your thinking, as long as you keep doing that, you'll never receive them. And you will come up short of what you should have as being a child of God. I know I just said something. Remember, child of God, that in all four of the Gospels, Jesus is the baptizer. I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. God said, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. In all four of the gospel, Jesus is the baptizer. You want to know where it is? Okay, I'm glad you asked. Mark 3:11, Mark 1:7 through 9, Luke 3:16, John 1:33. Jesus is the source. He is the source. He is the baptizer. Number four, child of God, you must have a hunger and thirst. You must have a hunger and thirst for this power from above. You got to want them. You got to want them. You got to want them. First, you got to believe. Then you got to want them like you just like you hadn't eaten in days, or you hadn't drunk any water in days. You got to hunger and thirst for this power from above. And look to the Lord. Look to Jesus to fill you. And if you have repented of your sins, and believe that this free gift, now let's say free gift, it is for you. You shall receive the Holy Ghost. Remember what happens to the folks in Ephesians, the disciples of John, in Ephesians 19. I know you all going to go back and check this out. And that's what I want you to do. Acts 19:2-6. Those brothers knew the Lord. And I'm going to bring this thing right down your street now. Those brothers knew the Lord. But Paul met them on the road and said, brethren, how y'all doing? He said, oh, we doing fine. Y'all know the Lord? Oh, yeah, we know the Lord. We love the Lord. We know the Lord. Well, let me ask you a question. Have you received the Holy Ghost? What are you talking about, Paul? We don't know what you're talking about. What Holy Ghost are you talking about? I'm glad you asked. And as the scripture teaches, he went on to instruct them in regards to the things of the Lord and brought them a little deeper into the Lord. The same thing happened with Apollos, with Priscilla and Aquila. Apollos was a preaching machine. They said, bro, you could preach somebody under the pew. But come over here a little bit. Let me bring you a little deeper into this Jesus thing, what this thing's all about. And you know the beauty of that? Apollos was receptive to what Priscilla and Aquila had to tell him. And it took him deeper in his ministry. Amen. Somebody, I hope you just caught what God just said. After the baptism, something happens after the baptism. Again, as Paul instructed the brethren of John, they received the message and they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul laid hands, according to the scriptures, I don't need the Greek, I don't need the Hebrew to break it out. When Paul laid hands on them, they began to speak in tongues. Child of God, there are many ways to receive the Holy Ghost. There's really no set way. There's many ways to receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Let me give you some ideas, and so you can get off to yourself. You know, don't necessarily listen to a lot of other folk who may not have the Holy Ghost, because they can't really tell you anything unless they do. You can have, and I know Pastor Clarice, you can relate to what I'm getting ready to say. You may have another spirit-filled believer to lay hands on you. That's what happened with Brother Paul. You may have somebody else to work with you who is spirit-filled to help you receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Amen. You may be alone in your room, in your car, in the bathroom. Don't really matter. You can be in a prayer meeting, as it was with the 120 in the upper room. Or again, you can be by yourself. The bottom line, child of God, is that you can receive Him anywhere. God will meet you anywhere when the atmosphere is right and your heart is ready to receive Him. And I'm about three. People of God, in these last days, We need every believer to be filled with the Holy Ghost. Child of God, we're living in a time now that the power of God needs to be in us. It needs to be operational in us in order to confront the evil things that are going on in this land, in America and throughout the world. A lot of things going on. Malagos, I've been praying for you over there. A lot of things are going on in Hong Kong, China. A lot of things going over here in America, too. We got mass shootings and people just losing their mind. All kind of stuff going on. We need the Holy Ghost in order to confront this evil that's in the world right now. People of God, we need God's power to deal with corrupt politicians. Yes. And even all these mass killings that seem to be happening almost daily. Almost. I think one weekend we had, two or three in the same weekend or something? About two or three in the same weekend. That's ridiculous. That's ridiculous. Unfortunately, people of God, there seems to be so much evil in the world today that the only way that this generation is going to see the manifestation of the power of God is through us. This generation has to be able to see the power of God operating in every believer to the point that they know that our God is real and that He loves them. This is the reason why the Lord wants all, somebody say all His people to be baptized in the Holy Ghost. It's not an option. It's a requirement. It is a requirement. People of God, no matter where you are in the world, don't let anybody tell you that the Holy Ghost is not for you, because the baptism of the Holy Ghost is for you. I have delivered God's word unto you on today. And I pray that this thing settles deep in your spirit. My leaders, all the pastors, I want you all to go back over this message. Everyone, go back over this message, write it out. Study it. It's not enough for you to hear it the first time. Sometimes, even myself, I have to go back and hear what God is saying. And then God will open your understanding to what He's saying, the deepness and the richness of the Scriptures. He wants you to have the Holy Ghost. Now, for those of you all, I told you all I'm going to get back to you. For those of you all who do have the baptism of the Holy Ghost, there's that thing that's called refilling, renewing. And that has to happen on a daily basis. Not enough just to have the initial infilling. You have to constantly want God to refill you with His Spirit on a daily basis. You got to do the repentance thing. Go before God, Lord, if it was anything that I did, which I know I probably did, and I don't even recognize that I did. Lord, please forgive me. You got to get that. Got to get that whole thing out of the way first, and do it on a daily basis, and then ask God to continue to refill you. And as you're refilled, you'll speak in your heavenly language before God. That's how you fill up. That's how you fill up in the Holy Ghost. So I've done that which of God has given me to speak to you all on today. I pray that you were blessed. And like I said, those of you all who don't have the Holy Ghost, don't have the baptism of the Holy Ghost, yeah, you have the anointing, you have the Spirit of God working in your life, but ain't nothing like getting them in there. There's nothing like getting them in there, because He will spring up out of your belly, living water. I didn't say dead water, I said living water. As the Spirit of the Lord moved, in the beginning in Genesis, as the Spirit of the Lord moved upon the waters were just stagnant. But notice what the Scripture says, as the Spirit of the Lord moved upon the waters, then they started to move. There's something I just said that if you hear what the Spirit of God just said, you'll hear what He's saying. You can be dead sitting right in church. Nothing really living. You're going through a ritual. You're doing a ritual. You're doing beautiful liturgy. Beautiful liturgy. But without having the Spirit, the Holy Ghost being in there, that's all it is. That's all it is. Beautiful thing. But when the Holy Ghost comes in, when He comes in, He directs. He directs. He'll move things. Folk will get delivered. People get baptized. People get rolling the floor. I know we used to call them holy rollers. I'm okay with that. I don't got no problem with that. But when the Spirit of God comes, you have no control. He goes past your intellect. Right, Pastor? She done found herself on the floor many a day. And wasn't trying. But I say that to say, I'm saying it in a funny way, but my point of emphasis is that when God's Spirit comes in, He takes up total control. Total control. Your feet get moving, your hands get to waving. And I'm not saying it's all about that, because it's really not. And noise is not necessarily anointing. I'm going to say that again. Noise is not necessarily anointing. Sometimes it's just a whole lot of noise. Because things can be done quietly, and you can see the Spirit of God move. And in some cases, He say, be still. And know that I'm God. You're moving around too much. You're doing too much. Just be still. I'm here. Let me do what I do. That was somebody out there. I'm done. None of that was here. That was him. None of that was here. So I'm done. I'm done. Praise God for you, Pastor Jacob. You guys finally came in. We praise God for you. Love you guys. Like I said, I don't take you for granted, because I know you guys got a lot of things going on with your own ministry. And you all are coming in from different parts of the world, Africa, Kenya. And we had a good conversation with my pastors there in Kenya the other day. So I'm looking for God to do some things there in Kenya. Amen. We're looking for that to happen. And some things there in Hong Kong, we got some things going on there too. So we praise God for all of you all. I'm done. We're going to.
I am washed, I am saved. the mercy of the Lamb and the bread. I feast now daily because I've learned to live in the grace that belongs to all who are
world.
Look what the Lord is doing. That's what happens when you get filled with the Holy Ghost. Yes. Even during a recording session. He will come in and mess it up. I don't know if y'all know. Y'all saw that? Y'all saw my sister in over there, had her own corner over there. She had, my wife's sister had her own corner over there.
Oh, my
God. You can't make this stuff up. This real. This real. It's real. Well, let's go and do our communion and let's go. Let's go. Y'all know where we're going with this. 1 Corinthians, 11th chapter. 1 Corinthians. I'm still feeling that. I got to ask the Lord to calm me down so I can get through this. 1 Corinthians, 11th chapter, 23rd verse through the 34th. Glory to God. Glory to God. Ain't nothing like having the Holy Ghost, y'all. Nothing like having. 11th chapter of 1 Corinthians, starting at the 23rd verse. For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup, when he supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament. Old Testament was good, but I like the New Covenant. In my blood, this do ye, as often as ye do this, drink it, you remember me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show forth the Lord's death till he comes. Wherefore, whomsoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let every man examine himself, so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many of you all are weak. You're sick. You got issues going on that you really shouldn't. This is the reason why. For if we would judge ourselves, I told y'all, go back and do that whole repentance thing every day. Because all of us mess up. We should not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world. I'd rather get it now than get it later. I don't know about y'all. Rebuke me, chase me now, God. Because I read in Revelations what you're going to do. And it ain't pretty, y'all. It's not pretty. When the seven vials of God's wrath be released into the earth, it's not going to be pretty. Well, how can a God so loving, I can hear somebody saying it. How can a God, God is holy. He going to take care of sin. It's going to be now or later. Which one you want? I'll take my whipping now. I'd rather get it straight now than have to stand before God. And when all that stuff is going on, I don't want to be around. I want to be looking from heaven. Suck to be them. God bless him. Anyway, let me move back to this. Where was it? Oh, yeah. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world. Wherefore, my brethren, when we come together to eat, tarry one for another. And if any man hunger, let him eat at home. When we come here to eat the Lord's Supper, like it's some smoker board. That you come not together unto condemnation. And the rest, Paul said to the Corinthian church, I will set in order. I hear God saying, and the rest, I will set in order when I come. Amen. 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 Well, people of God, we've come to that place where we all bind ourselves together in as they say, in Christian love and all that sort of stuff. But this is when the body, we bind ourselves together. We're a community. We're a community of believers. I had a brother that asked me, I'm off track a little bit. Brother that asked me the other day in Chile, and he asked me, he said, Bishop, do you need a priest here in Chile? You know, do you need to start a community here in Chile? I said, glad you asked. And he's of another denomination, but God is doing something. We'll work that thing. We're gonna work that. God is good. All the body, we're one throughout the world. And this is what we do. We come together and commune with one another, commune with God in communion. Amen. I want you all to lift your I want you all to lift up your bread and your juice or whatever you're utilizing. And we're going to bless it in a minute, right after I do the priestly thing.
Okay.
I want you guys to go back. I know some people probably wonder why we do that. I want you to research it for yourself, preachers. When the high priest went before God as far as the sacrifices, that sort of stuff, he also had to cleanse his hands. He had to cleanse himself. It's called a massive. Makes M-A-S-S-I-V-E. So you can research that for yourself. Because now I act as high priest. Okay? Again, lift up your elements. Father God, we thank you, Lord God, for this day that you've blessed us to see, Lord God. We ask you, Lord God, to turn these natural elements into that which is spiritual, Father God. We thank you and we praise you for all things that you have done and what you are doing in our lives, Lord God. We ask you to bless each one of the members of EMIC, bless each one of the members of EMIC worldwide, even those children, God, that you've given us that I don't know. And I say that because, Lord, I see them coming and calling me daddy. And they're following us. I don't know them personally, but God, you know them. And I praise God for them. Lord, we ask you to continue to bless them and bless their families, Father God. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. People of God, the bread represents the broken body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which he didn't have to do it, but because of his love for all of us, when we was polluted in our own blood, messing up, we couldn't even see ourselves as we were, but he did it just for us. His body was broken, scarred from the head to the feet, literally, but he did that for us. Take, eat all of it. People of God, the fruit of the vine represents the blood, the shed blood of Jesus Christ, that which was shed on Calvary's tree for you and I. Without the shedding of blood, there's no remission, meaning there's no removal of sin. There had to be a sacrificial lamb. There had to be some blood spilled. And he shed his blood for you and I. Take, drink all of it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father God, we thank you. We thank you, Lord, for Calvary. We thank you for this time that we had to share with your people, Lord God. Lord God, we thank you and we praise you for all things. Again, we ask you to bless each one of these members, Lord God. Bless their families, Lord God. If they have any issues going on in their life, God, you know what they stand in need of, Lord God. Minister to their needs, Lord God, no matter what they are. Father, these are your children. These are your children, Lord God. And we stand as one. We stand as one throughout the world, that we represent you, Lord God, until you come. Lord God, we ask you to continue to be with us in all that we do and all that we say. Lord God, we ask you to bless this ministry. Bless my wife and I, Lord God, as we continue and strive to do that which you've called us to do. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen, 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 amen. Amen, amen. So glad everybody came out on today. Like I said, I know you guys are doing stuff. I know y'all busy. And those of y'all who are going to watch the replay of the you can unmute. You can unmute. Talk to me, Pastor Jacob. Y'all can talk to me now. Yeah. But, amen. We praise God. We praise God for everybody. I saw Elder Mark was in there for a few minutes, too. I saw him earlier. So I know he was tending to some other things. And like I said, we praise God for you. Had a little technical difficulty in the beginning. I hope y'all look past that. But it's okay. It's all good. It's all good. The devil is a liar.
Amen.
He just didn't want that to come through.
No, he didn't.
That's what that was all about. He didn't want that to come through. And those that are, and you know, some people probably had problems coming in on today. And I know I knew the reason why. I already knew. Because I knew where God was going to take me. Anytime you get ready to go to another level in God, He's not going to sit still. Don't y'all get that twisted. He ain't going to just sit still. When you get ready to go, certain things, y'all have to understand this. I know I'm babbling now. You have to understand this. He came from glory. So there's certain things He can see, because He was anointed at one time. There's certain things He can pick up. So when He sees that you starting to do this, and you getting ready to get some word that's going to take you to another level in God, watch out. Watch out. I'm praying for each one of you guys' ministry. Pastor Jacob, I'm praying for that ministry that you're getting ready to build. I'm praying. I'm talking about the physical building. And all of you all who have building projects going on and that you're expanding the kingdom, my prayers is with you. I want to teach you something. That when God does it, you will know it was God and it wasn't coming from a resource. I told y'all something the other day, Bishop ain't rich. Bishop got to go to work. Bishop got a job. But listen to what I'm saying. When God does it, it'll blow your mind. You say, Lord, have mercy. I know there was nobody but God. Because ain't no way that didn't work out on paper. Them numbers wasn't there. No. I don't care how I did old math, I did new math. That stuff wasn't adding up. But look at God.
Look at God.
She got a testimony, I tell you. stuff started happening and you don't know where it was coming from. Yeah. But that's how you know it's God. That's how you know it's God. He said, a lot of times He just wants us to trust Him, be obedient, and then back out of the way. And y'all know we struggle. Get your mind from around it. Because if you keep trying to figure that thing out, you're gonna get a headache. You're gonna get a migraine. So you don't want to do. Just trust God. Watch Him work it out. I've already claimed that building that we have there in Kenya, son. That's gonna happen. Don't fret it. Listen to the voice of God, and watch Him work it out. Watch Him, Clarice. All of you all that are doing certain things in the kingdom. There's a lot of you guys that are doing things. I won't share it with everybody. There's a lot of you all that are doing different things throughout the world. But trust in God. It ain't gonna necessarily come from America. We got our own issues.
Yeah.
So watch God work. I love you guys. Y'all know Bishop love you. You know Bishop love you. Pastor love you. And